Tune in to The Family Factor with Denny C. every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday mornings at 6 a.m. Central, 7 Eastern, as he looks at all the challenges facing the family today. Denny will give you a refreshingly new look at tackling some of the biggest issues. So start your day off on the right foot with Denny C. and The Family Factor, right here on K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do whatever you can to save money. One of our biggest expenses can be our cars, especially when unexpected repair bills hit. Not anymore. If you own a vehicle with less than 130,000 miles, is less than 12 years old, has a warranty about to expire, or even no warranty at all, you could stop paying for car repairs. Roadside assistance, towing, and rental coverage are all included. Don't wait for the next repair. Make one free call right now to see if you qualify. If your vehicle is less than 12 years old, has less than 130,000 miles, even if it's out of warranty, paying for car repairs can become a thing of the past. Call us right now and get your car protected before your next repair bill hits. Get protection and no more repair bills. Call 800-696-1030. Again, 800-696-1030. That's 800-696-1030. 800-696-1030.
You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. A division of RCE is now the Spark Radio Network. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark. You're listening to K98 Talk, the way internet radio should be.
Well, hi, this is Denny C. with The Family Factor. We hope that this show will be a help to you as you search for answers with things, with problems and issues within your family's life.
Now, here's Denny C. on The Family Factor.
God, we still trust.
All right, good Monday to you, everybody. We hope you had a good weekend, and we hope that everything's going well. And this is Denny C. for the Family Factor. We thank you for tuning in. We're kicking off Monday, and we're going to be talking about different things. And we hope that this week is a good week to you. Today, we're going to be talking about, you know, when you're told the end is near. Now, there's different ways you can take that statement. you know. If you're, you know, we could say the deathbed, but what brought this up, somebody who is dear to our hearts here at the Family Factor, was told by a doctor that all that needs to happen now is the cancer that this person has, if it goes into any of their bodily organs, it's in their bones, but if it spreads to the bodily organs, that's it, it's over. I mean, doesn't exactly give you a really oomph for life, you know, but and of course that takes me to that one movie with Jack Nicholson and Morgan Freeman, where he's told he's going to die, and so he wanted to go ahead and get everything that he always wanted to do out of the way and get things resolved in his life, and just because you're told something like that doesn't mean it's going to happen. And I don't mean that in a weird way. I'm just saying. I mean, the doctor has to say what the doctor has to say. Now, there are those who are told that they have a few days to live and then they live for years. You just don't know what's going to happen when you're told these things. That's why you just pray to the Lord and you move forward. I mean, my hope is that the person who's told this will not give in to that. They'll just move on, you know. just one day at a time. Because let's face it, guys, you don't know when you're going to die. You could, you know, the day you're born, you're basically told you could die. You know? I'm not saying that that's going to make things different. It's just when you're told that you're going to die, well, you knew that the day you were born. We're not always going to make the right decisions, and all we can do is just move forward. But the reason I brought this up is because this can basically cause somebody to grieve. First of all, the one who's told they're going to die, but then those around them who don't want to wake up, and maybe in which, you know, I think it would be better if it's, if someone were to pass away, they'd pass away in their sleep while they're resting. That's just, to me, a better scenario or situation. But, you know, in other words, that there's not any pain in the passing. But that led to an article that I was reading where basically Megan, she never thought she'd have to deal with death, at least not at this age. Her older sister Linda was a picture of health and vitality, and until her car collided with a semi on the way back to college, and she was killed instantly. Extremely popular and intelligent, Linda seemed most invincible to 16-year-old Megan. And on the flip side, Tony wasn't surprised when he received word that his dad had died after struggling for 5 years with lung cancer. He'd seen his dad endure chemotherapy, radiation treatment, hospitals, tests, and more tests, and in the end, his dad's death seemed inevitable. And I guess that, you know, the second part of this discussion I was talking about with Tony is kind of like this other lady that I was telling you about. So whether we're like Megan or Tony, none of us knows exactly how death will touch our lives until it does. Where it's just out of nowhere, boom, this person dies, or the other one's told they're going to die. And you've got to live with the unknown factor of what time of day, what second, what minute. So we all know that facing death can't be avoided. In a single year, more than 2.4 million people die in the United States. In a single year. And we see deaths everywhere. Some of them are staged. In fact, by the time the average child leaves elementary school, we will have witnessed 8,000 murders, 100,000 other acts of violence on TV. On the other hand, some of the scenes are real. The horror on the faces of, say, the Columbine High School students that were caught on camera as they fled out of their school back in April of 1999 will be etched in our minds for years to come, including those kids recently when that happened out on the West Coast. Those situations may be rare, but they do happen, and they happen to real teens. I mean, another way teens see death in their world is through suicide. Do you realize that more than 33,000 Americans took their own lives way back in 2006, and that has increased over the years? And it's likely that you know of someone who has either attempted or committed suicide. So what are we talking about here? Grieving. Grieving is a painful but a necessary process. And though people are living longer, society hasn't and will never come up with a way to eliminate death. And where death exists, sadness tugs at our hearts. You probably wouldn't be reading this, you know, or seeing about this or listening to this show. Because there's different, you know, there's articles, there's news when you turn on the news. Then, of course, there's this show today. But you probably wouldn't even be hearing about this if you hadn't experienced some type of loss. I mean, the death of a loved one or even a pet, an injury, a dream that seems unattainable now, or your parents' divorce. Losses come in all shapes and sizes. And you may not be responsible for the loss at all, but it doesn't change the fact that you hurt. You know, it takes my mind back to when the Lord Jesus said, "Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted." Mourning doesn't just happen at funerals. It can happen whenever we face a loss, no matter what it is. Some people just don't mourn. Why? Because it's too painful. We were initially created for a world without sadness, so we try our best to dodge it whenever possible. But mourning is a process that helps us deal with our sadness. It's healthy, even though it's difficult. For instance, you know, here I am a guy, and if you're a guy, you may be feeling pressure from others to be strong and let those emotions show. But in reality, the hurt is still there whether you face it or not. And when you choose to avoid it or to bury it inside, it doesn't help. As painful as they may be, emotional wounds need to be exposed. To whom? Your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You see, He can heal them. He accepts us with our sadness and wants to comfort us and promises His will. And if we hide the pain, guess what? We will pay the price. And if we bury the pain, guess what? It will often bury us. We might be consumed with resentment that surfaces when we least expect it. We might avoid others so that we don't have to be reminded of our own losses. And unfortunately, some of us may turn to drugs or alcohol or sex as a way to numb our pain. Or we might get just downright angry because it feels safer than sadness. But we can be sure that if we don't face the loss, we won't experience lasting comfort. Think about that. And there is a better way. Grieving. Grieving is invaluable. And it's a skill that can be used throughout your life in many situations. And if you understand how to grieve, you can avoid a lot of unnecessary heartache down the road. What I'm saying is, don't be the kind of person who just puts it off, looks the other way, act as though you're not being hit by that. Because that's, as I stated a moment ago, it's going to create other issues in your life. However, if you know how to grieve, and you grieve when you need to grieve, it's going to help you in so many ways. So what are the tasks of grieving? Now, you may have heard someone say that grief has different stages, and that we will have to walk through each stage to get past the pain. Talking about stages of grief can be helpful for understanding our reactions as long as we don't view those stages too rigidly. They don't always follow a specific progression. Grieving people don't say, quote, "I'm now at stage one and I'm just about ready to step into the next stage." No, they don't say that. You see, stages can blend, and sometimes you may be skipping back and forth and back between them. And for that reason, it may be more helpful to view them as four grief tasks to work through, rather than four consecutive stages. You know? So let's think about task number one. And this is an important one. Actually accepting the reality of the loss. That, I think, when I've counseled people, has been probably one of the most hardest tasks. Just to accept it. Just accept that you've lost your loved one, or you've lost your friend, or you've lost your job, or you've lost your dog, you know, whatever the loss is. People sometimes, depending on their personality and their makeup, do not want to accept it. They want to act as though they never heard it. But when you first hear about a loss, I'm telling you, you may experience shock or denial. You might think, no, this could not have happened. It just doesn't make sense. And it may take a few weeks for your mind to catch up with reality, but, you know, difficulty sleeping, a change of appetite, or a strong desire to be with others may show up at this point in your life as well. Now, in extreme cases, people may experience delusions as they wait for the loved one to return. This is how Queen Victoria responded after the death of Prince Albert. At times she spoke to him in the palace and had his clothes laid out, ready to be worn. Now that may sound bizarre, but people often do similar things in more subtle ways. For instance, you might deny how much the loss hurts, saying, quote, you know, I can always find another friend, no big deal. Or, well, my parents, they're fighting a lot with each other. Divorce is probably the best thing. And though these denials may be temporarily deadening the pain, having a clear picture of what you just lost will help you move to the second task. So back to the first task. You've got to accept the reality of what happened. You've got to accept the reality of the loss. The second one is working through the pain of grief. I mean, when the truth finally hits you, it's not as though you'll wake up from a dream and find everything back to normal. In fact, as time goes on, you'll become aware of how this loss will change your life forever. Not only are you likely to feel the deep sense of hurt, but there may be a strong anger toward another person, yourself, and believe it or not, even God. Some people get mad at God when this happens. And these emotions can be intensified on certain dates, such as your brother's first birthday after his death, or your parents' wedding anniversary after a divorce, or the anniversary of the loss itself. Recognizing and allowing yourself to feel the pain is an honest reaction that can eventually help you to heal. That leads us to task number 3. Accept your world with the loss. Once you face the despair with time and God's help, you will increasingly be able to accept the loss and realize the life goes on. There's a buddy of mine. He's been stressing out, bless his heart. He had the money and the means to buy a really good house in the country on acres. And he got all of his place and he got all his stuff in place. He had to make sure he had a good credit, you know, a good credit rating for him to be able to get the loan. And so he strove hard for years to get all of this in place. Well, so he gets things ready for the date they're going to sign to get the house. And guess what happens? The other side did not finish what they're supposed to get done. Therefore, they had to do an extension a week later or 2 weeks later. Oh, boy. Okay. Well, you know, all right. I understand. Now, that stressed him out, but it's like, oh, you know. Well, then, the next year, same thing. They moved ahead, and once again, he got everything ready. You know, I mean, to the next sign-in. Oh, boy. They didn't get one of those things done. So, again, they had to put it off again. You know, so he's been stressing. And he accepts it, but it's hard for him to accept it. But back to this point. Once you've faced the despair, with time and God's help, you will increasingly be able to accept the loss and realize that life goes on. You may have had your identity wrapped up in the person or relationship that had been lost, or I understand that you still have identity apart from what has been lost. It's necessary to move ahead. Acceptance isn't about trying to block the loss of your mind. Instead, it's about realizing that the loss will change your world and that you still meant to have a whole healthy life. So, task 4. Have place for your memories, but move on with life. In some ways, there's a continuation of task 3. Here you are able to take specific, concrete steps to go on with your life in this new world. Memories and sadness remain, but there's a new strength to move on. In this stage, you will be able to look back at how you've grown from the entire ordeal, and you may even reach out to others who are hurting. I mean, I was thinking about when God was talking to Joshua, in Joshua 1 and verse 2. You know, in Joshua 1 and verse 2, God tells Joshua, "Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people get ready to cross the Jordan River." Now, Joshua already knew that Moses was dead. That was obvious. But God was giving Joshua the opportunity to move forward with the plans God had for him. And if we choose to stay stuck in grief and loss forever, we'll never know how God could have used us. We'll never know. So how can you grieve? Okay, so you understand that dealing with grief and pain is sometimes a long road, and that you may have to walk the same section of it several times before healing starts to happen. But that doesn't sound very encouraging, does it? It's just the walk. The walk is the hardest part, right? Fortunately, there are some specific things that you can do while you're walking that road. Now, while no single action is the key to everyone's walk of grief, some of these suggestions may be of a great help. Well, I tell you, we'll be right back. I think we need to take a quick break. This is Denny C. for the Family Factor. Again, we're talking about how to deal with grief along the way. We'll be right back after this commercial break.
You can reach Denny C. of the Family Factor by tweeting him at Family Factors or the Family Factor at live.com. You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. A division of RCE is now the Spark Radio Network. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark. Tune in to The Family Factor with Denny C. every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday mornings at 6 a.m. Central, 7 Eastern, as he looks at all of the challenges facing the family today. Denny will give you a refreshingly new look at tackling some of the biggest issues. So start your day off on the right foot with Denny C. and The Family Factor, right here on K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
When our water heater broke down last month, it was a nightmare. It took 5 hours for the plumber to show up, and he charged us a couple of $100 just to come out. Then it cost another $1,800 to put in the new water heater. By the time it was all said and done, I felt like I'd been taken. But what else could I do?
The smartest thing you can do is get a home warranty from American Residential Warranty. Their home warranties pay to repair or replace all your major appliances when they break. And they will break. And at the worst possible time, call American Residential Warranty right now for free information on home warranties starting at just pennies a day. Don't wait for your refrigerator to stop running or your ceiling fans to stop turning. Call American Residential Warranty right now. Ask how you can save up to 50% on washer and dryer coverage. Just call 1-800-513-6154. That's 1-800-513-6154. Again, 1-800-513-6154. Call now.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
This is the most transparent administration in history. Not even a smidgen of corruption.
Fact is, we had 4 dead Americans. What difference at this point does it make?
If you got a business, you didn't build that.
Oh, welcome to the face. Welcome to the face of the new democracy. Come and
It's time to hear the truth about America's biggest challenges. Tune in to America Off the Rails with Rowdy Rick Robinson on iHeartRadio, K98 Talk, and Blog Talk Radio. Rick, a conservative who's not afraid to say what's on his mind, tackles the issues that threaten to derail our nation. So join him to get your daily dose of the truth as he tries to keep America from coming off the rails. You're listening to The Family Factor with Denny C. on K98 Talk. Join him bright and early every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday mornings as he covers issues that relate to the family. Denny encourages your calls and emails with topics you would like for him to discuss. So set your alarm for 6 a.m., grab that first cup of coffee, and join The Family Factor to start your day. Now back to Denny C. and more of The Family Factor.
Well, we're glad we're back. We hope you had a good two-minute waiting time there. And we thank you for tuning in. And again, you can always write to me at thefamilyfactor@live.com. You can write to me at dennyc@thesparkradionetwork.com. You can also follow us on Twitter at The Family Factors. And you can follow us on Facebook at facebook.com/TheFamilyFactor. Well, we thank you for tuning in today. Again, we're talking about when you're told the end is near, how do you deal with it? Or how do you deal with grieving when a friend of yours is told they're going to die, or they have passed, or you've lost your job, or your animal died, or whatever the situation may be. So we're talking about how can you grieve? You know, understanding that dealing with grief and pain is sometimes a long road, and that you may have to walk the same section of it several times before healing starts to happen. But that doesn't sound very encouraging, though, does it? Mm-mm. Fortunately, there are some specific things you can do while you're walking that road. And while no single action is the key to everyone's walk of grief, some of these suggestions, mind you, they're just suggestions, may help you. Number one, you need to identify what you've lost. I mean, this sounds easy enough. You know, my sister was killed, my horses died, my parents were divorced, but try to go deeper than that. Besides the obvious loss, what are you going to have to live without? You know, are you losing a friend? Are you losing a source of stability? Are you losing an encourager? Sometimes writing down your losses, listen to this, sometimes writing down your losses can allow you to come back later to see how the relationship impacted you and in some ways touched you in a way that made you who you are. The next point is touch your pain. You can identify all your losses in your brain, but true grieving requires you to use your heart. A funeral service might help you to focus on your hurt, but when it's over, the sadness will still be there. To continue working through your pain, you might write a letter to the person who died. It's obvious, not for the person's benefit, but it may help you to review what you appreciated most about him or her. Or you could visit that person's graveside and speak your heart. Often the closer you were to the person you lose, or that you lost, the more you'll hurt. So maybe making a scrapbook can help you sift through tangible reminders of that person. You may experience memories that aren't enjoyable, but for healing to happen, the hurts and fears connected with a critical parent or hostile peer should be felt as much as the positive memories. Now, another thought you might think about is tell your story. Although other people may experience the same loss, your story is unique. Feeling the emotions help, but conveying them to others can bring an even deeper healing. Now, I'm sure this will happen with those who went through the recent shootings out on the West Coast. But for instance, right after the Columbine High School tragedy back in 1999, students and school personnel were encouraged to talk to people about their feelings. Through their tears and their words, they shared their experiences not so much to aid the police investigation, but to help in their own recovery. So talking to a parent, a counselor, a minister, your spouse, a youth worker, a friend can validate your emotions. Even sharing your experience with a trusted friend or adult in a letter may open the door for loved ones to talk with you about your grief. And once you've told your story, you'll probably need to retell it. And yet you'll find that each time that you retell it, your heart will heal a little bit more. The next point is, do not deal with your regrets. How many times we have regretful thoughts, like if I only had gone to basketball practice that day, I could have kept my sister from the accident. Or if I hadn't been thinking about myself, I could have stayed up with Dad and been with him when he died. So there's a lot of thoughts of the what ifs. And most of the time, our regrets come out unexpectedly with unreasonable expectations of ourselves. I mean, your mind may race through thoughts like these that I was talking about, trying to figure out how you could have kept death or loss from happening. But you can't. It just happens. One day, you and I will die. And we'll review the events in our minds and come to the inaccurate conclusion that we could have made a difference. But you need to realize that those feelings will be there. Many times people wish that they had died instead of the other person. That's called survivor's guilt. This survivor's guilt creates a sorrow over having survived when someone else died or was injured. So besides the unrealistic regrets, there may be times when we really have blown it. We may wish we hadn't said that we did, you know, what we did, and hadn't acted in a certain manner. And talking with a loved one, a parent, maybe your pastor, can help you get a handle on the degree to which your regret is realistic. I mean, speak to God about it. Tell God if there is something you wish you could have changed, you could have changed. If you need to confess something, confess it. Because God will forgive you. To anybody with a repentant heart. The next point is, don't bury your resentments. People may not always have treated you in the best way. No one is perfect. And at some time, parents, friends, siblings, and teachers have all let you down. And when a person who has hurt you dies, the feelings you've built up toward him or her can make the grieving process, believe it or not, harder. So dealing with your hurt or anger is important so that the feelings can heal and not fester. I mean, I don't know how many times I've seen it happen with different people I've counseled where they really had a problem with that other person that died, and then it hurts them to have those feelings over the hurt they experienced in connection to that person. It's like a catch-22 in their hearts. But the alternative is the resentment that develops with anger freezes inside us. I mean, in Hebrews 12 and 15, it tells us, you know, see to it that no one misses the grace of God and that no bitter root grows up to cause trouble and defile many. So you hurt yourself and others when you let that bitterness grow in you. You may be afraid of your anger and not know what to do with it. You may use that anger as a shield to keep you from further hurt, but when you bottle it up, resentment, it spills into other areas of your life, including other relationships, without realizing it. We often let resentment build up because we think it shows a lack of respect to feel anger towards someone who has died. So we leave the other person on a pedestal and try to bury our emotions, but bitterness doesn't help anyone. Sometimes the only way to let go of your anger is, guess what? To give yourself permission to feel it and then let it out in a healthy way. Okay? So don't bury any resentments to those who passed away who you had a problem with. Now let's talk about a really important one. You need to take a break. It takes time to work through loss. You're not likely to do it in a moment. if grief hits us continually, we probably wouldn't have the strength to deal with it. Think of it as waves of an ocean. There are moments of calm between the swells, and some of them are smaller than others. And there will be times when it feels as though a wave has just smacked you down. But the grief will be, and the grief will be intense, but then there will be calm times when you can regain your strength and footing until the next experience of grief moves in. Setting aside specific times to write out your feelings. Now, this is important. Listen to this. You need to set some time to write out those feelings. Why? Because they can help you identify your grief. For instance, when your mind wanders from a math assignment, you can tell yourself that you need to be thinking about algebra at that moment, and that there will be times to journal later. That way you don't have to deal with grief all the time, but you constantly find blocks of time to face it. So, in some ways, you may never get over the pain. The intense times of grief will get further and further apart, but you'll have reoccurring memories that can still bring sadness. And although mourning is healthy, at some point you must choose to move ahead. How long should you grieve? That's a tough question, and one that is definitely not has an answer. It really depends on your experience and your personality. I mean, I was thinking about different things that can help us. If you have the feeling like, you know, life stinks and God, you made it that way. If you have that attitude, it's never going to go away or get better. You can have a shifting, what we call a shifting attitude. You blame God, then you don't blame God. And then finally, you open up your heart and realize it's just life. So sometimes we look at a multiple choice test. If, you know, like for instance, I face the pain, or I look at the truth behind the pain. But it's not one way or the other. We need to do both. You need to face the pain, and then you need to look at the truth beyond the pain. I mean, for men are not cast off by the Lord forever, though he brings grief. He will show compassion, so great as his unfailing love. That's what the Bible says. So after facing the sadness, it may be helpful to write out truths of encouragement to remind us of God's compassion on a weekly or daily basis, no matter what the loss has been. You have to live, or you have a life ahead of you worth living. So keep in mind, along the road of grief, many people fall into potholes because they can't see clearly what's up ahead. And think about these things when you're stuck in that kind of a journey. Number one, no two people grieve the same way. Just because you grieve this way doesn't mean I do. And just because I grieve this way doesn't mean you do. Grief is not a cookie-cutter matter. People deal with loss differently. It's important that you grieve or decide to grieve, but you don't have to shed a certain number of tears. Parents, teachers, friends, and others may have certain ideas about how you should grieve and tell them that you appreciate their desire to see you work out your sadness, but without criticizing them. Let them know how you need to grieve. Talk to them about the steps you're taking to deal with your loss. In most cases, their greatest desire is just to see you work through your emotions. So, no two people grieve the same way. Everybody grieves differently. And life doesn't stop for your pain. I mean, can you imagine how nice that would be if you would take a specific amount of time and grieve without having to worry about anything else in life? I mean, what if you could just set your alarm clock for 2 years from now and know that whatever choices you make in the time won't bear any consequences? It's a nice thought, but it's not reality. You still have to get along with your parents, your friends, and yes, your jobs, your life, your children. Choice you make during the time of grief will affect you either positively or negatively, just like they do when life is normal. So, choose wisely. Now, another point, an important point, is watch out for unhealthy affections. When it comes to grief, words sometimes don't help a whole lot. Job's friends sat with him in silence for 7 days because they saw how much he hurt. That's Job 2 and verse 3. And sometimes we just need to be close to someone else in silence with a hug or an arm around our shoulder. I mean, ask a family or friend for the closeness you need, but set boundaries. You could end up in a situation that could be wrong if you're not careful. And then old losses may still need to be mourned. You know, people tell me all the time, well, that was a long time ago. It doesn't affect me anymore. I mean, how could it? I barely remember. But there is a part of you that still hurts. You know that song, Love Hurts? I will not sing it, but it happens. So, what we need to do is we really need to understand death. We need to see how death affects us. I mean, you know, we could do the old cartoon characters that get flattened on the road, but in the next frame they jump up ready for more. That's not life. That's not real life. When somebody dies, they're dead. And so, and until Christ comes back, death is here to stay. So without getting morbid, what does the Bible say about death? If we're to define what death is, what is it? Well, death came after sin entered into the world. They do know death, Adam and Eve. And it's hard to imagine that there was a time when death did not exist on the earth, but there was. Death doesn't respect anyone's status. It's no respecter of persons. It will take everybody. I mean, in Psalms 49:10, for all can see that wise men die, the foolish and the senseless alike perish, and leave their wealth to others. So no matter how much money you earn, you can't take it with you, and there's going to be a day when each one of us dies. Now, Jesus has demonstrated the power of death. Matter of fact, Paul wrote Timothy in 2 Timothy 1:10, our Savior Christ Jesus has destroyed death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. If we ask Christ to forgive our sins and we receive Him into our hearts, we don't have to fear death. We will live with Him forever. The next point is, you can receive the free gift of forgiveness and live with God when you die. For Paul wrote in the book of Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. So the best way to know how to grieve someone else's death is to make sure you're ready for your own death. Have you ever accepted God's free gift? It's not about being perfect or getting yourself cleaned up for God. It's about knowing that you've blown it, like everyone else, asking God to forgive you, and asking Him to be your Savior and Lord. There aren't any magic words. You just need to open your heart. You need to realize the importance of living for the Lord. Now, it doesn't take the hate away or the hurt away that you have, but it helps you deal with them, to get over them. I mean, no one can make you grieve. You have to decide if you will. And the questions that you may have, that we've talked about even, hopefully helped. But if you don't want to bury your emotions, think about them with your heart. Look to the Lord to give you courage to face the pain. Talk to your spouse, talk to your friends, maybe talk to your pastor or counselor about your grief. If you feel stuck, it may also help you to speak to the Lord Himself. So, in questions to think about, if you have somebody who is passing away or has passed away, you might want to think about these questions. You know, what have I lost in my life? And how will that loss affect me now and in the future? What will I miss the most? What anger do I have, if any? Are there any losses I've buried in my past? What regrets do I have, if any? Are they realistic? Do I need to forgive anyone for hurts I've experienced? What specific actions can I take to grieve my loss in a constructive manner? Have I been able to talk to people about my loss? Are others willing to talk to me about my hurt? When am I least willing to touch my sadness? Have there been times I've thought about ending my life? And this is one that's important. Sometimes, believe it or not, when somebody dies, they just want to go be with them. They'd rather just die themselves. Or they're dealing with a life experience they just don't want to live through anymore. Maybe they have a illness themselves. You know, not the Kardashians. What's his name? The assisted suicide guy. Doctor, I can't remember his name. It might be Kardashian, I don't know. And then you have, are the choices I need to put on hold until I work through my grief? What do I need from other people? Have I asked them without demanding that they respond? Now here's one that I think many people, especially Christians, are going to automatically think. Does God really care about my pain? And what's the future He has for me? And what have I learned from my grief? Remember, grieving is never an easy process. It never is. But God is available to give you His comfort and peace. And in time, you will be able to move forward in your life. So grieving is something that we have to deal with in different times of our life. Now, either we can give in to the bad side of grieving and we can give in to things that hurt our lives and make them far worse than they would have been. Or we can face it. Find those that can help us to move ahead. Grieving comes in different ways and from different situations. Maybe you worked really hard in school and you failed your test. Maybe you've worked really hard in just getting your credit score up and getting your life in order, and it just doesn't seem to happen overnight. Maybe you've been trying to get healthy. Maybe you've got a lot of weight on and you're trying to get healthy and lose your weight, and it just doesn't seem to be falling off. You see, grieving is not just in cases of somebody passing away. It can come in different ways, different shapes, different forms. Perhaps it's when somebody else gets that promotion you wish you could have got, that you tried hard to get. Whatever is causing the grieving, just remember, don't give up, don't stop. Just keep moving ahead. For in so doing, you're going to definitely, definitely get things going to where they need to be. Well, it amazes me how these things happen in our lives. And it's up to us to get things, you know, ready, to get things where we're moving ahead. Because if we don't, our life will never be what it could have been. We have to somehow find within us the hope, the help. And sometimes we have to look to the outside for those sources, for the help and the hope. Well, this is Denny C. We thank you for tuning in this Monday. We'll be back Wednesday morning. And remember, when you're told the end is near, don't give up on life. Just move ahead slowly, one step at a time. Thank you for tuning in.
Thank you for tuning in to The Family Factor with Denny C. Be sure to join him every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday mornings at 6 a.m. right here on K98 Talk.
God, we still trust here in America. He's the one we turn to every time.
When our water heater broke down last month, it was a nightmare. It took 5 hours for the plumber to show up, and he charged us a couple of $100 just to come out. Then it cost another $1,800 to put in the new water heater. By the time it was all said and done, I felt like I'd been taken. But what else could I do?
The smartest thing you can do is get a home warranty from American Residential Warranty. Their home warranties pay to repair or replace all your major appliances when they break, and they will break, and at the worst possible time. Call American Residential Warranty right now for free information on home warranties starting at just pennies a day. Don't wait for your refrigerator to stop running or your ceiling fans to stop turning. Call American Residential Warranty right now. Ask how you can save up to 50% on washer and dryer coverage. Just call 1-800-513-6154. That's 1-800-513-6154. Again, 1-800-513-6154. Call now.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.
Tune in to The Family Factor with Denny C. every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday mornings at 6 a.m. Central, 7 Eastern, as he looks at all the challenges facing the family today. Denny will give you a refreshingly new look at tackling some of the biggest issues. So start your day off on the right foot with Denny C. and The Family Factor, right here on K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
This is the most transparent administration in history. Not even a smidgen of corruption.
Fact is, we had four dead Americans. What difference at this point does it make?
If you got a business, you didn't build that.
Oh, welcome to the face. Welcome to the face of the new democracy. Come expect just to be a mistake. We're paying off election debts to those on the take.
It's time to hear the truth about America's biggest challenges. Tune in to America Off the Rails with Rowdy Rick Robinson on iHeartRadio, K98 Talk, and Blog Talk Radio. Rick, a conservative who's not afraid to say what's on his mind, tackles the issues that threaten to derail our nation. So join him to get your daily dose of the truth as he tries to keep America from coming off the rails. You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. A division of RCE is now the Spark Radio Network. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark.
In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do whatever you can to save money. One of our biggest expenses can be our cars, especially when unexpected repair bills hit. Not anymore. If you own a vehicle with less than 130,000 miles, is less than 12 years old, has a warranty about to expire, or even no warranty at all, you could stop paying for car repairs. Roadside assistance, towing, and rental coverage are all included. Don't wait for the next repair. Make one free call right now to see if you qualify. If your vehicle is less than 12 years old, has less than 130,000 miles, even if it's out of warranty, paying for car repairs can become a thing of the past. Call us right now and get your car protected before your next repair bill hits. Get protection and no more repair bills. Call 800-696-1030. Again, 800-696-1030. That's 800-696-1030. 800-696-1030.